America is essentially a
good evening, and welcome to tonight's program of Network X. And I think we're discussing a very broad, very deep, and critical question tonight, which is the issue of representative democracy in the United States, its history and its status. And we're very fortunate to have with us as our guest Professor Walter Williams, who is Professor Emeritus of the Evans School at the University of Washington, the author of a forthcoming book entitled Reaganism and the Death of Representative Democracy, and an earlier book called Mismanaging America. And he spent a large part of his distinguished career dealing with the subject. Good evening, and thanks for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
And since that's our topic, where do you think the best place to begin is?
I think probably the best place to begin, at least from my point of view and from the perspective of the book I did, is with the New Deal, and we can move quickly. But the New Deal comes after a period in the 1920s not too dissimilar to the current period. When Roosevelt comes in fighting the economic depression, he brings in a pro-government, more egalitarian view that becomes the dominant political thinking and carries on certainly well into the 60s. I myself served in the Office of Economic Opportunity in Washington from 65 to 69. And this was a period in which those at the bottom were to some extent gaining on those at the top, and a unique period in American history, the ultimate period of egalitarianism in the United States, which may not be what we would like, but at least the lower and middle income people are gaining on the upper income people. And then as we pass into the 70s, the big factor is the OPEC oil price increase in 73 and then again in 79. And this turns the economy down. In the period from 48 to 73, productivity, which is the driver of economic growth, is 3%. And it's never been that high before, and it's never been that high again for any extended period of time. This is what I call in my book the golden years. Then as we go into 73 and the rest of the 70s, we get Jimmy Carter. People don't like Jimmy Carter. People begin to dislike government. And then you get the second OPEC increase, which sends us into double-digit inflation and double-digit interest rates. And you have then, starting in 64, the rise of Ronald Reagan, his speech at the Republican National Convention in 64 when Barry Goldwater was nominated. Reagan emerges as the star, the new...
Before we get... Can I ask a question about this already?
Sure.
I've heard the view, which is they would evince the following historical facts, that up until shortly before the First World War, unions were really put upon, in the early American history, unions were illegal. in that middle period before the Second World War. If people go out and strike, the National Guard might be called out to fire on the strikers and so forth and so on. But that when America went into the Second World War to ensure that there would be labor tranquility at home and that there would be high production at home to enable them to win the Second World War, that's when this accommodation with labor, and labor was given a relatively bigger share of the pie than before, and that some of this is also seen then as the moneyed interests wanting to take that back after the Second World War. Do you think there's any credence to that view?
Well, it doesn't happen that way, is the only thing I would say, is that Franklin Roosevelt is certainly not thinking about a world war in 1933 when he moves to create the New Deal and Social Security and a number of programs. There's no question that we want to have a productive labor force. We want to, but business wants people. But remember, it's in 44 that there's a GI Bill, which creates creates the middle class, if you will. So I tend not to take great conspiracy theories. I do assume that the wealthy, that the business owners, are trying to make the most money that they can, and they are often prevail in terms of getting labor to get the short stick. But it is in this period up to 73 that labor, at least the lower and middle classes, are gaining against the upper class, and that ends in 73, and we begin to see a different kind of philosophy. And the thing I would emphasize is that the philosophy of the New Deal saw government as a positive force, and Roosevelt was a powerful figure who didn't like business, didn't like rich people, although he was of their class. Lyndon Johnson was a fighter for the rights of people. I mean, I have great problems with Lyndon Johnson in Vietnam, but the Lyndon Johnson that I served in 65 and a few was a great man. Was a man who wanted to help those who were downtrodden. Those of us who escaped from, I come from Texas too, those of us who escaped from Texas as liberals, and Johnson couldn't be one until he became president, have a sincere wish to help those who were terribly mistreated. I mean, I grew up in that atmosphere, and it was the next thing to slavery in Tyler, Texas in the 40s. I mean, we kept the black people in their place, and those of us who escaped that did not wanted to help the people who were being held down, and government was seen as a positive force. This was the government that won the Second World War, that established the GI Bill, or this is the government that built the interstate highways by a conservative Republican, Dwight Eisenhower, who fostered graduate education, again Dwight Eisenhower. And it is in this period when things start turning down that the conservatives, the right wing of the Republican Party, which has been a fringe group, becomes the majority group. And the seller of that philosophy is Ronald Reagan. I'm not saying he's an evil man. Reagan believed in all his heart what he said, and he saw America as a shining thing. It's as if there were never Native Americans murdered, or that
slave labor didn't build the country.
Yeah, or the railroads sprung up by themselves, or that somehow people acquired 160 acres after the Homestead Act of 1862 by themselves without anything to do. Government didn't exist for Ronald Reagan, except to be bad or in defense. And He truly believed in a pure America that provided the greatest democracy in the world, all superlatives. And then he had a very anti-government view. He thought that government held back business. The dead hand of government is what keeping us from recovering. And further, he believed in what I would call market fundamentalism. If we just let the market work right, everything will be good. Business will prosper, labor will prosper. We don't need any protection with regulations. The businesses will police themselves. And so you can trace a line, and talking about deregulation, you can trace a line from this aspect of Reaganism to the savings and loan scandal to Enron. I mean, it was, most of what they thought was wrong. But it was deeply believed, and it fit what the American people really thought. Most Americans knock the government. They say, oh, government can't do anything. They're always fouling things up. They're against taxes. They don't want to pay taxes. They don't seem to, maybe they'll understand from it is happening now, that somebody's got to pay for the goodies that we want.
But, you know, again, I am, you know, so close in agreement with what you're saying, but I see a couple of things a little different. I mean, I think that I'm not sure that the word conspiratorial is the correct word, but this plan to readjust the balance in favor of the ownership class rather than the working class, I think was much more systemic than just the beliefs of one Ronald Reagan, and that even this business of the OPEC price increases, I think, had a very strategic purpose, and that the United States colluded with those, because a lot of the thinking of the working class supporting the government was based on a notion that we are in a world of plenitude, and that there is everybody can improve. We can have a world where everyone can have the things they want. But what the OPEC thing does, it says, no, we're really in a world of scarcity, and all of these retrenchments are based on scarcity. And I would also say that I would see, as part of the class struggle, is the media and the other forces of the wealthy selling the idea to the public, trying their best at every moment to sell the idea that the government is not in their interest, and the government is incompetent, and the government can't do anything, so forth and so on. And that's part of the strategies of the wealthy in trying to adjust that balance between capitalism and democracy.
I think the facts don't support what you're saying. I think we have this period, let's say from 48 for a quarter century, in which most of the time government is admired. Now, you know, we begin to have other problems. We begin to have race riots and these kinds, and it gets very convoluted. But certainly the government is seen as positive for a long period of time in those years. Sure, business wants its more than its share, but there's also a group of elites who are very public sector and very public interest oriented, and they actually fight against the business people who want everything. In fact, there's a guy named John Judas or Judas, I'm not sure whether I'm pronouncing it correctly, who has a book on the elites, and he basically says it's the fact these people have disappeared. The folks like the great names Acheson and those folks who went back and forth with business into business and or law and, mm-hmm. and the government, who kept the system honest, who fought back the people who wanted to unbalance capitalism or give capitalism the advantage and beat down democracy. It wasn't Reagan as a person. in the small sense, it was Reagan as a prophet of a new way of thinking. He was a very charismatic figure. It's very strange. You may not think that, but he was able to sell the message. There's a fair amount of stuff written on how charismatic figures arrive and how if they have the right message and they have the ability to sell it, when the two come together, it's explosive. Hitler was like that.
No, I was about to say, you know, this is so fascinating and your perspectives are very fascinating. We are now halfway through the show. So I would like to, and maybe I want to apologize for my raising some of these broader issues, but I would really like to jump us up to the Bush here, and let's take a look at what Bush is doing and the possibility of his actually impeachable or illegal activities that he is going through as part of this overall scenario.
Okay, let me just finish up.
Sure.
The important thing is that Reaganism survives Reagan, and it gets picked up by people like Newt Gingrich. You get a kind of mean Reaganism. You get the 1994 election, where you get this huge number of very right-wing Republicans, and you get a nastier Reaganism, although it still has the same principles. And it what we have is Bush does not reject Bush first Bush. Clinton does not reject it. In fact, Clinton validates it much as Eisenhower validated the New Deal. And so you come 20 years later to George W. Bush, and you have, and I haven't covered this very much, you have our institutions badly damaged. Like Congress is almost unable to pass a budget. The White House, and part of this is Clinton's fault, has become a propaganda mill. Clinton had the best spin shop since Reagan, and Bush excels both of them because this is the first administration that uses deception as its main tool of policy. And this is what's important. I'm not saying that we haven't had presidents who lied to us before. Certainly Lyndon Johnson did in the Bay of Tonkin, Gulf of Tonkin, I'm sorry. Kennedy was lied a number of times. But they didn't base all of their policies. This guy has lied to us about the most important domestic and the most important foreign policies. The income tax cut, which is terribly important and has put the middle class at terrible jeopardy, and the war. If you take the income tax, where he starts it, and where people like me who were very interested in the income tax immediately, can see that this guy is taking the truth and twisting it. He engages in what I have called earlier the big lie. Now, the big lie is a statement that is technically true, but is so misleading as to be dangerous. I'll give you an example. When he had the first tax bill in early in the administration, George W. Bush says those in the lowest tax brackets get the biggest percentage tax cuts. Well, that's true. That is precisely true. It's true because we've cut back income taxes a lot on those folks, and they don't pay very much, so when you give them a few dollars, it's a pretty high percent. If you give them $200 and they only pay them $400, that's 50%. What he doesn't say is that 75% of the people pay more in Social Security taxes than they do in income taxes. So if you just cut income taxes for the low-income people, they're not getting that big a break if you look at their total federal taxes. But when you come to the top, there are tremendous gains. And my argument and of course, we've had so much now about the 16 words and about sure. Great Britain. I don't think I need to say this. But what you have, it seems to me, is this. That the founding fathers, and I tend not to see them as I tend to see them as brilliant individuals who wanted a government that worked. I mean, they were not. They were aristocrats themselves, but I think to Madison or to Hamilton, it would have been unthinkable for a president to lie and mislead the American people on major issues of policy. To come out and say, you folks get the biggest percentage, to imply that you folks are doing better than those at the top, when in fact the truth is those at the top are raking it in. I'll give you one example. It's the example I think is the most striking one ever, and this is about a proposal, and it was never it didn't get, part of it got enacted, but when in the second big tax cut this year, the cutting out taxes, income taxes on taxable dividends, if you had done that in the way that Bush proposed, the top 260,000 plus families, which is 0.2% of the population, would benefit roughly equal to the 145 million people who make $140,000 a year or less. Now, this is obscene. And yet this guy is telling the American people, looking at them in this pure, I am virtuous way, and saying, I'm helping you folks, and I'm not just giving the money to the rich. And it to me, in doing that, he violates the notion of the public having enough information to make right. a reasoned decision. And it seems to me, if you read the oath of office, where the president swears that he will do the best to uphold the principle of the United States, that this is a total violation. It is so much worse than what Clinton did. It's worse than what Nixon did. Nixon was, both of those things were terrible. I'm not condoning Bill Clinton, I'm not condoning Richard Nixon, but they did not purposely mislead the American people in the most important issues facing them, in the tax cuts that were critical, the most important domestic policy in years, and going to war in Iraq. And that seems to me to be something that I would consider an impeachable offense. Now, I'll be the first to say, A, I'm not a lawyer. B, I know the American public would never buy impeaching George Bush, or it's unlikely they would now. And C, that probably people think that politicians lying is perfectly normal, and they don't understand, it seems to me, the basic nature of our government, which is a government of consent. When Lincoln said a government of the people, by the people, and for the people, shall not perish from the earth, that's why we were fighting. He would have been aghast at what George Bush is doing. This is not a government of the people, by the people, or for the people. It is a plutocratic system that George Bush is entrenching. And it had started earlier. It was, and when I say a plutocratic system, I mean that the wealthy have sufficient control over the government that it does much of what they want. Now, in American politics, the people still have power. The people, it would be wrong to think that the people don't have power because the politicians fear getting on the wrong side of the people on a big issue. They don't want to be against something that, that lots of Americans are for. And they respond. But most issues are not of that kind. And the issues that are big, important to business, which have to do about the minutiae of tax legislation and these kinds of things, are where business is able to score and change a line in a tax bill or something like that and make billions of dollars that never gets to the surface. So the control is always at a certain level, but it's the level that provides profit. The whole Enron thing is like that. Everything's below the surface. We never saw what was going on. We never saw that the accountants were certifying things that were untrue. We never saw that the stock analysts were touting stocks that were terrible. But that's where the American people lose out.
I'm speechless, and I think you are. We have far too little time, and I think that you have painted a very good and realistic and scary picture. We haven't even touched upon the aspects of the administration with regard to eliminating civil liberties directly through various kinds of legislation. And you are also not the only person to be saying this. I was glad to see that last week, Professor Akerlof, who is a Nobel laureate in economics, echoed your sentiments almost to the T. And he's an esteemed professor at the University of California. And thank you very much for watching Studio X. Please call us at 525-0087 and let us know what your opinions are, what shows you'd like us to do in the future, and join us next week, and we will continue shows on these topics. Good evening. Just